He was born a slave and died one of the most influential teachers of his time. But Epictetus wouldn't have considered himself a teacher. He was a philosopher, a Stoic philosopher, a man who sought a very specific kind of knowledge, the knowledge that when applied helped with facing and overcoming the inevitable difficulties of life. And through a combination of his own life experiences and the wisdom of his mentor, the Stoic philosopher Musonius Rufus, Epictetus had the kind of insights that people traveled hundreds of miles for the chance to hear, even if only for an hour or two. They sent their children to hear him. Even the poor, the affluent, the powerful, even the future emperor Hadrian, were told they all vied for a chance to sit in and sit down at Epictetus's feet. And fortunately, there was a young man who regularly got to listen in to Epictetus, and he wrote down what Epictetus had to say. And remarkably, these notes survived to us and have been passed on to some of history's greatest figures over the last few thousand years. The Roman Emperor Marcus Aurelius wrote in his journal thanking the man who had loaned him a copy of Epictetus. Theodore Roosevelt famously carried a copy of Epictetus with him along his incredibly dangerous River of Doubt expedition. Admiral James Stockdale had Epictetus with him as he led fighter squadrons in daily combat in Vietnam, and it was on Epictetus whom he leaned when he'd had to survive 7 years as a prisoner of war. The list is endless, and hopefully after this video you'll understand why and add your name to the list of Epictetus's admirers, because he truly was one of the wisest and most inspiring people to ever live. "Our first job is this," Epictetus said, "to divide and distinguish things into two categories, externals I cannot control, but the choices I make with regard to what I do control. Where will I find good and bad in me, in my choices?" This single skill, Epictetus said, will change your life. The art of differentiating between what's up to us and what is not up to us, what we have influence over and what we do not. "A flight is delayed because of weather. No amount of yelling at an airline representative will end the storm. No amount of wishing will make you taller or shorter or born in a different country. No matter how hard you try, you can't make someone like you. On top of all that, time spent hurling yourself at these immovable objects is time not spent on the things we can change. As Epictetus said, all we can control is the choices they make right now. And the same is true for you. Focus on making clear what parts of your day are within your control and what parts are not. You will not only be happier, but you will have a distinct advantage over all the people who fail to realize they are wasting their time on unwinnable battles. It is not events that disturb people," Epictetus said, "it's their judgment about things." Albert Ellis, one of the most influential figures in modern psychology, said it was this line that guided the development of cognitive behavioral therapy. Epictetus said it was the most important power we have. Something happens, but we decide that it's unfair or bad or a failure. Someone says something, but we decide that it's offensive or presumptuous or rude. If someone succeeds in provoking you, Epictetus said, realize that your mind is complicit in the provocation. Events are objective. The opinion that they're objectionable is just that, your opinion, and you always have the power to change it. Get rid of self-conceit, Epictetus said. It is impossible to learn that which one thinks they already know. Epictetus kept his eyes and ears open, always actively looking for opportunities to learn from everyone and everything. And this is the attitude we must take with us day in and day out, whether we're one of the best at what we do or just starting out. It doesn't matter. Every person we meet, every situation we find ourselves in, every book we read or movie we watch, there is an opportunity to learn, to keep getting better, to take another step forward on the path to progress. And that was one of Epictetus's favorite questions. How have you made progress? More than anything else, we answer that question by focusing on what we don't know, on where we can get better, on where we can improve, rather than patting ourselves on the back for how great we are. The true man is revealed in difficult times, Epictetus said. So when trouble comes, think of yourself as a wrestler paired with a tough young buck. For what purpose? To turn you into Olympic class material. We can think of hardship many ways, as failure, as unfairness, as the end of the conversation. Clearly, this was not meant to be, we say. They don't want me to succeed. What's the point in trying? Or we can choose, we can train ourselves to see it a better way, as grist for the mill, as a chance to learn about endurance, patience, resilience, struggle, as a chance to prove our mettle, as resistance that is making our muscles stronger, as a sparring partner. Epictetus preferred the latter and became in his time and in ours the ultimate symbol of the ability of a human being to overcome dark circumstances. He said it was not about accepting hardship or resigning ourselves to it, but agreeing to work with it, to decide to make the most of it, to see hardship as an opportunity, not as an obstacle. And in this way, we can turn everything that happens to us into fuel, and we can be made better and stronger by everything that happens. Would you really know what philosophy offers humanity? Seneca once said, philosophy offers counsel. Born at the turn of the first millennium, a time of paranoia and violence and political turmoil, Seneca needed counsel, just as you need counsel. He read widely and eventually discovered a school of philosophy known as Stoicism, founded in Greece only a few centuries before. There, in the works of the Stoics, Seneca found what he was looking for, guidance on how to live a good life. And soon he began writing letters and essays to family members, friends, promising young talents, sharing the wisdom that changed his life. Because nothing will ever please me, he said, no matter how excellent or beneficial, if I must retain the knowledge of it myself. No good thing is pleasant to possess, he said, without friends to share it. There are more things likely to frighten us, Seneca wrote, than there are to crush us. We suffer more in imagination than in reality. Seneca's life was full of suffering. He was born with a chronic lung condition. He lived through the reigns of the first five emperors, each increasingly more deranged and violent than the previous. He was exiled and lost everything twice. And yet, for all this suffering, his advice was that the only thing we should be worried about is what we're worried about. We spend so much time imagining, worrying in advance, that we actually torture ourselves more than the thing we're worried about ever could. And that is, of course, if it actually happens at all. The most important thing to remember about pain and suffering, Seneca said, is that it is inevitable. It can't be avoided. But what we must avoid is the phantom premonitions of what may or may not happen. Instead of suffering in imagination, focus on what's immediately in front of you. Stay in the present. Stay in reality. Excellence withers without an adversary, Seneca said. As fire is the test of gold, so adversity is the test of strong men. We like to live comfortably, to minimize inconveniences, to not have to do what we don't like to do, to find what we enjoy where we enjoy it and never leave. But Seneca said that this is a kind of death trap. A person who has never been challenged, he said, who always gets their way, is a tragic figure. You have passed through life without an opponent, he said. No one can ever know what you are capable of, not even you. Which is why Seneca talked over and over again about the importance of adversity, of not only embracing the struggle life throws at you, but actively seeking out that difficulty so you can be stronger and better and more prepared. Every day, he said, we should look to challenge ourselves. We should make choices that push us rather than help us atrophy. And when we are going through something tough, we should be grateful for the chance that it is helping us realize our full potential. Associate with those who will make a better man of you, Seneca said. Welcome those whom you yourself can improve. The process is mutual, for men learn as they teach. Jim Rohn's widely quoted line is that you are the average of the five people you spend the most time with. James Altucher advises young writers and entrepreneurs to find their scene, a group of peers who push them to be better. But Goethe's maxim is better. Tell me whom you consort with, and I will tell you who you are. And Seneca said, if there's one thing we should be especially careful of, it's who we surround ourselves with. I never bring back home the same character that I took with me, he said. There is no person who does not stamp their character upon us or taint us unconsciously. We have to consider who we allow in our lives. We can't be afraid of cutting ties with old environments or relationships when it's clear that they're no longer serving us well. We can't be afraid of reaching out to new people or to make an attempt to break into new and better social circles. The stakes are high. As Seneca put it, just as some diseases jump over onto those we have touched, so the mind infects those closest to us with evils. This is our big mistake, Seneca said, to think we look forward to death. Most of death is already gone. Whatever time has passed is owned, by death. Like many philosophers, death was a common theme in Seneca's writings. Let us prepare our minds as if we'd come to the very end of life, he said. Let us postpone nothing. Let us balance life's books each day. The one who puts the finishing touches on their life each day is never short of time. But Seneca's greatest contribution on the topic of life's final act is that it wasn't actually a final act. Death, Seneca realized, is not something that lay ahead of us in the uncertain future. He realized that we were dying every day. The time you have spent listening to this video, you have died just a few minutes. No day, no minute, no second once dead can be revived. It's not that we have a short time to live, Seneca said, but that we waste a lot of it. There is therefore only one thing we should do, he said, live immediately. So if you take anything from Seneca's writings, from his wisdom, from the philosophy that so offered you counsel, it is that go out and live now while you still can. Fortune is fickle. Do not wait. Take it now. Live while you can. There was no one like him. Marcus Aurelius, the last of the five good emperors. Marcus Aurelius was a student of Stoicism, an ancient school of philosophy founded in Athens in the early 3rd century BC on the belief that we don't control the world around us, we control only how we respond. Marcus was the leader of a world facing a pandemic which spanned 15 years, civil unrest, wars on the border, cultural decadence, income inequality, and so much more. And so it's easy to see why he was drawn to this philosophy. He compared himself to someone seeking relief from a rash or a burn, and that Stoicism was his soothing ointment, a warm lotion. And that's why Marcus Aurelius tried to provide in Meditations his only known work, a totally unique and peerless document in the annals of history, to pass on this ointment, this guidance, this medicine to future generations. As Bran Blanchard, the historian, would note, few now care about the marches and countermarches of the Roman commanders. What the centuries have clung to is the notebook of thoughts of a man whose real life was largely unknown, who put down in the midnight dimness not the events of the day or the plans of the morrow, but something of far more permanent interest, the ideals and the aspirations that a rare spirit lived by. And that's what Stoicism was designed to be, medicine for the soul, relieving us of the vulnerabilities of life and restoring us with vigor to what we need to thrive. At dawn, when you have trouble getting out of bed, Marcus Aurelius said, tell yourself I have to go to work as a human being. What do I have to complain of if I am going to do what I was born for, the things I was brought into this world to do? Or is this what I was created for, to huddle under the blankets and stay warm? It is one of the most relatable moments in Meditations, this argument Marcus Aurelius was having with himself in the opening of Book 5. It's clearly an argument he had many times on many mornings, as many of us have. He knows he has to get out of bed, but so desperately wants to remain under the warm covers. It's relatable, but it's also impressive. Marcus didn't actually have to get out of bed. Being the emperor meant that he didn't have to do anything. He could have slept in every day without immediate consequence. No one would have docked his pay. No one would have asked him why he was late. And yet here Marcus was insisting that he rise early and get to work. Why? As Dante wrote in his epic poem, beneath the blanket is no way to fame. You can't accomplish anything curled up under the covers. Marcus knew that winning the morning was key to winning the day and winning at life. He knew that being the most powerful man in the world still didn't exempt him from living as nature requires. He knew that his status didn't mean anything and that his obligations to it were waiting for him to wake up. He knew that sleeping in would only mean that he had a lot of catching up to do and that he had handed over control and was now in reactionary mode. And so it's simple. If you want to be productive, get more done, and be great, you have to get up early. Our actions may be impeded, Marcus Aurelius wrote, but there can be no impeding our intentions or our dispositions because we can accommodate and adapt. The mind adapts and converts to its own purposes, the obstacle to our acting. The impediment to action advances action. What stands in the way becomes the way. One way to go through life is to turn away from hardship. You can close your ears and eyes to what is unpleasant. You can take the easy way, foregoing difficulty whenever possible. The other way is the Stoic way. We can choose, we can train ourselves, we can see hardship as an opportunity, as grist for the mill, as a chance to learn about endurance, patience, resilience, and struggle. We can see it as a chance to prove our mettle, as a way of learning about people or situations or actions or things. And Marcus Aurelius believed in the latter approach. He wrote about how fire turns everything that is thrown into it into flame. He says that obstacles are better seen as fuel. It's not about accepting hardship for the Stoics then, or resigning ourselves to it. Rather, it's a matter of agreeing to work with it, to decide to make the most of it, to see hardship as an opportunity and not as an obstacle. And in this way, we can turn what happens to us into fuel. We can be made better and brighter by everything that happens. We can turn the obstacle into the way. If at some point in your life, Marcus Aurelius wrote, if you should find anything better than justice, honesty, self-control, and courage, if you find anything better than that, embrace it without reservation. It must be an extraordinary thing indeed. While Marcus Aurelius was writing Meditations, Rome was invaded and a war followed that would last 5 years. The Tiber had one of its most severe floods in history, destroying homes and livestock, which brought famine into Rome. Eventually, that war, returning soldiers brought home with them a deadly contagion, which became known as the Antonine Plague. Crippled by famine and plague, numerous hostile tribes in the north seized the opportunity to band together and attack the Romans. For the remainder of his reign, he faced the twin evils of plague and war. And yet, Marcus mentions none of these horrific events in his journal. He does, however, mention that there is no challenge, no problem so big that it prevents him from responding with the four Stoic virtues: courage, moderation, justice, and wisdom. That is, to not be afraid, not to give in to our baser instincts, not to put oneself above others, not to get lost in what is up close, but to see the bigger picture. He said that everything he faced was an opportunity to respond with those four virtues, which made even the most complex situation simple and straightforward. Just that you do the right thing, he said. The rest doesn't matter. Remember this principle, Marcus Aurelius wrote. When something threatens to cause you pain, the thing itself was no misfortune at all. To endure it and to prevail is a great good fortune. Things we didn't want to happen, they happen to all of us, including Marcus Aurelius. A business deal falls through, a grade comes back that we didn't expect, a person we care about leaves us. Our instinct is to call these events unfortunate because they are not what we wanted. It makes sense. It's fortunate when you get what you want. It's unfortunate when, for whatever reason, you don't. Right? Marcus Aurelius proposes a different way of looking at things. Instead of telling ourselves that we're unfortunate because our expectations were disappointed, he said we should do the opposite. No, it's fortunate that this has happened, he says, and I've remained unharmed by it, not shattered by the present or frightened of the future. It could have happened to anyone, but not everyone could have remained unharmed by it. To a Stoic, we're harmed only when our character is affected. We're only harmed when we let go of what we believe in or when we drop our own standards. It might not be desirable to lose money or a friend, to fail at something or be criticized, but how does that make us unfortunate? We haven't been deprived of our ability to respond. Our character remains intact. There's no rule that says you have to freak out by this, be shattered by it, or that you have to start getting anxious about the future. No, you're still in control. You're still you, and that's very fortunate. You could leave life right now, Marcus Aurelius said. Let that determine what you do and say and think. Pierre Hadot called Meditations a collection of spiritual exercises, and there is no exercise that Marcus does more than meditating on his mortality. Perhaps it was his own health issues that made him so acutely aware of death. Perhaps it was losing his father at an early age. Perhaps it was losing 8 children. Perhaps it was the Antonine Plague that killed somewhere between 10 and 18 million people. Perhaps it was the realization in the power of memento mori, the ancient practice of reflection on mortality that goes back to Socrates, who said that the proper practice of philosophy is about nothing else but dying and being dead. Most people push back on the memento mori that Marcus Aurelius did as being morbid or dark. Most people want to avoid thinking about death. It's unpleasant, it's scary, it's sad. Why would would anyone want to think about a thing they don't want to happen? All of this misses the point. It's not about making you anxious about how few days you have left. The purpose is the opposite. It's to free you, to inspire you. It is the key to happiness that unlocks empowerment, gratitude, charity, and a bonus round attitude every moment of every day. Memento mori is the jolt that keeps us in the present moment. Marcus Aurelius liked to ask, who on earth would think of their mortality, that they could only have a few minutes left on earth and go, yes, I should spend more time being upset or afraid or depressed. Our mortality isn't depressing, it's energizing. It turns down the volume on pointless, stupid, divisive matters we waste so much energy on, because in the light of death, very little is worth getting angry or stressed or overwhelmed about. So keep reminding yourself, just as Marcus did, you could leave life right now. Let that determine what you do and say and think.